بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن اتبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وإنك لعلى خلق عظيم. وقال تعالى: وما أرسلناك إلا رحمة للعالمين. وقال تعالى: ولو كنت فظا غليظ القلب لانفضوا من حولك. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: إنما بعثت لأتمم مكارم الأخلاق. وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام: أكمل المؤمنين إيمانا أحسنهم خلقا، وخياركم خياركم لنسائهم خلقا. وعن أنس رضي الله تعالى عنه أنه قال: كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أحسن الناس خلقا، أحسن الناس خلقا. وعن أنس رضي الله تعالى عنه أنه قال: لقد خدمت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم 10 سنين، فما قال لي قط أف، ولا قال لشيء فعلته لما فعلته، ولا لشيء لما أفعله ألا فعلت كذا. وقال: ولم يكن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فاحشا ولا متفحشا، وكان يقول: إن من خياركم أحسنكم خلقا أخلاقا. صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم، ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. Respected علماء, respected elders, brothers and sisters listening at home, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He sent His prophets from the time of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam till the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, He sent all the messengers and He sent all the prophets for one purpose, and that is for us to recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for human beings to be guided, that we know what to do on this earth. Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam came and he told the people that this is what you need to do. Only a few people listened to him. And then other prophets came. Salih alayhi salatu wasalam came, Hud alayhi salatu wasalam came, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam came, Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam came, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam came, Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam, Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. All these prophets came with this guidance, that what do we do on this earth? How do we behave on this earth? And then eventually Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We owe everything to the messenger, our beloved, the last prophet of Allah, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most beloved to Allah. We owe everything. So whenever his name is said, then we should always send salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. An angel will pick up your durood and salam, and an angel will take your durood and salam, and it will take it to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will give you reply. There was a buzrug and there was a saint. He was standing outside the masjid of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he was sitting and he was looking at the green dome. So whilst he was sitting there, somebody asked him that, what are you doing here? He says, I am looking at the aeroplanes. He said, but there is no aeroplanes, because aeroplanes are not allowed above the masjid of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He said, there's no aeroplanes. He says, I'm not talking about those aeroplanes, PIA and Saudi Airlines and British Airways. I'm talking about the angels that are flying into the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they are saying to the Prophet of Allah that so and so in London is sending you durood, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying wa alayka salam. So whenever we hear the name of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, say sallallahu alaihi wasallam with love, with love. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came as a guide for you and I. We are extremely fortunate that you and I are from the ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ne hame yatim hokar nahi chhora. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not leave us as orphans. He completed the deen. He completed the deen. And then he left this world and he taught everything. Everything. And there's two angles that we need to be understand that Islam is a relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is our relationship upwards. But then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also guided us towards a relationship towards human beings. And anything that is on the earth, whether it's plants or whether it's animals or whether it's human beings or anything that is on the earth, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us and guided us towards our relationship with our Creator Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he also guided us towards our relationship with fellow creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fellow creation of Allah. And these manners, Islamic manners that we talk about, adab, akhlaq, whatever you want to call it, this is extremely important and is part of Islam, part of Islam. It is not an add-on that if you want to do it, then you do it, and if you don't want to do it, then you don't do it. No, it is part and parcel of Islam. Many of the akhlaq, many of the adab, many of the manners, etiquettes, ethics, they are mentioned directly in the Quran. And some are mentioned by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But this is part and parcel of Islam. And it's like a house. Islam is like a house. The akhlaq, the character, the ethics, the etiquettes. When you walk into a house, and the house from the outside is beautiful, the house on the inside is beautiful, is decorated beautifully. The lights, the chandeliers, the walls, the wallpaper, the table in the dining room, the kitchen, the bathroom, the toilet, everything is shiny, the tiles in the toilet, beautiful. But if there is no bunyad, if there is no foundation, then you can go into the house and say, mashallah, very beautiful, very beautiful. But after a few days, after a few weeks, after a few years, that house will fall down. So etiquettes are important. Very, very important. But the first and foremost that everyone has to understand, that Islam has a foundation, and the foundation is Bunyal Islamu ala khamsin. Bunyal Islamu ala khamsin. Shahadatu an la ilaha illallah. First is the shahada, la ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. And then 5 times daily salah. And then Sawm, fasting in the month of Ramadan, zakat and hajj. This is bunyad, this is foundation. Some people say, well, he's got good character. Well, my heart is good. Therefore, my namaz is in the heart. No. You can't pray namaz in the heart. Is there anyone who has come from the time of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam till the day of judgment whose heart is greater than the heart of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And yet, not only did he used to perform 5 times daily salah, he used to perform tahajjud salah, ishraq salah, awabin salah, duha salah, all the different salah. If you think your heart is good, it can never be better than the heart of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Foundation, foundation. Islam is on a foundation. The foundation is first, shahadatu an la ilaha illallah. Then 5 times daily salah. You can't miss the salah. Our youngsters make a habit from young age that we never ever miss one salah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us 24 hours in a day. Out of 24 hours, He is asking maybe 10 minutes for each salah. 1 hour. 1 hour he is asking from us to thank him for what he has given us, and we can't even give 1 hour. And then fasting in the month of Ramadan, zakat and hajj. So all these are pillars. If that foundation is there, then on that foundation you then start with the akhlaq. Then you decorate the house. And the more beauty there is in the house, then the more it is shining in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Akhlaq is for who? Akhlaq is for who? Akhlaq is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Character is so important that today Muslims, unfortunately in this country, we have been here for 50 years, more than 50 years, 60 years, 70 years. Our elders, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them more strength, give them good health. They say Ameen. The youngsters don't want to pray for the elders. We should say Ameen. If you pray for those people who are elders, then when you become old, Allah will give you the strength as well and health as well. Okay? So don't be stingy in your du'as. Make du'a for yourself, make du'a for others as well. One sahabi, he was praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, oh Allah, grant me and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Jannah. Grant me and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Jannah. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard him. He said, Jannah is not that small. Pray for everyone. He was only praying for himself and Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yeah? So similarly, we should pray for everyone. So our elders, they made these masajid because of which we are here today. Because of which we are here today. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them the highest reward. Those who are alive and those who have passed away as well. May He fill their qabr with nur. So these elders, they have made these masajid. They have made these masajid. So the kazib actually. Akhlaq decoration. Yeah, I was going on to mention something about the elders. They came 50, 60 years ago and they built these masajid. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala ali sayyidina wa nabiyyina Muhammad wa barik wa sallam. So we have to build a foundation, and on top of that we have to make the nice house, the akhlaq. Our elders, they came 50, 60, 70 years ago. They have been in this country, and we have been in this country for 50, 60, 70 years. Today, if we ask a non-Muslim, what do they think about Muslims? What do they think about Muslims? The Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'een, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, there wasn't many Sahaba who had gone out into different parts of the world. There weren't many Sahaba who had gone beyond Arabia. But suddenly, as soon as Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, especially at the time of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the Sahaba started going to different places. And if you look in history, majority of the places that were conquered and taken over by Muslims were not conquered by the sword. They were conquered by the akhlaq and the character of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is why they say that the miracles of Allah, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the miracles of the prophets, which Allah used to give the prophets, they used to change. They used to change something. So for example, if you look at the miracle of Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, then a blind person, if Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam used to put his hand over the eyes of the blind person, the eyes that were not seeing suddenly used to see. So from not seeing, now they are seeing. Hazrat Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he had a stick. If he used to throw it on the ground, it would become a snake. The stick would become a snake. There was a changing element in the miracles which were given to the prophets. The Quran is the greatest miracle of Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pointed to the moon and split the moon. That is not the greatest miracle, it is one of the miracles of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went from Makkah al-Mukarramah to Masjid al-Aqsa and then up to the seven heavens and came back within a millisecond. That is one of the miracles of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but it is not the greatest miracle. The greatest miracle of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the Holy Quran. Is the Holy Quran. This is why we see sometimes there are scientists who read the Quran and they see something in the Quran and they think, how can a man who came in 571 AD in the 6th century could have told us this when we have only found out this in the 21st century, and they become Muslim. This is why today that a young 6-year-old girl, only 3 weeks ago, I was in London, in one of the places, a 6-year-old girl had finished Hafiz of the Quran. Not just reading the Quran. Today we are struggling, Alif, Ba, Ta, Tha, at 6 years old. And this girl had finished the memorization of the whole Quran. This is a miracle of the Quran. This miracle, the question is, if Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam would put his hands and make a non-seeing eye become seeing, and if Hazrat Musa alayhi salatu wasalam would throw down the stick and it would become a snake, what has the Quran done in terms of changing? It did not change anyone in terms of physical complexion. Bahir se kisi ko nahi badla. It did not change the companion's face. It did not change the companion's hands. It did not create a snake and it did not split the moon. But what the Quran did, it changed the hearts of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that change in the hearts permeated and went through every single person that it met, so that they would then realize that this is not a human being on this earth, this is an angel. جو درندے تھے ان کو انسان بنا دیا بلکہ انسان تو کیا ان کو فرشتے بنا دیا. Those people who were not, they were Roman Empire and the Persian Empire. Persian Empire and Roman Empire were the biggest empires. But they didn't even look at Makkah and Medina and Arabia because they thought یہ تو جاہل لوگ ہیں. They are jungly people there. Why should we go and rule over there? There's only deserts there. But those kind of people, the Quran came and changed their hearts, and those people who are regarded as people who are really, really backward, they became the angels on the earth. And when they started to travel in different places of the earth, by the time of Hazrat Usman Ghani radiallahu ta'ala anhu, lots of Arabia, parts of Arabia, parts of Spain, parts of India had become Muslim. Not because of the sword, because of the akhlaq and the character. And today, we have been here for 50, 60 years. We have been here for 50, 60 years. But we have to admit that instead of us showing the people that this is the way you should behave, we have taken on their character. We have taken on their character, which is full of un-Islamic etiquettes, un-Islamic manners, not Islamic manners. ہم نے اپنے اسلامی اخلاق کو چھوڑ کر ان کے اخلاق کو اپنایا. We have left our Islamic manners, our Islamic adab, our Islamic ethics, our Islamic etiquettes shown to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we have taken over theirs. And that is why when they talk about Muslims today, they can't see the difference. یہ بھی پیسے کے پیچھے پڑا ہے, یہ بھی پیسے کے پیچھے پڑا ہے. What's the difference? He is after money and I am after money. What is the difference? But there was a huge difference. Huge difference. The Islamic manners that were taught. Recently, there was an article in the Independent or one of the newspapers. And in there, a Scottish man, he said that I had never met a Muslim and I became a Muslim. I had never met a Muslim, less than 1 month ago. I had never met a Muslim, but I became a Muslim. Alhamdulillah, he didn't meet a Muslim. Alhamdulillah, he didn't meet a Muslim because then he would have had doubts, ke ye Islam hai. Maybe. He said, I read the Quran. From the first page to the last page. And after reading the Quran, he said, I went to look for a masjid and I stepped into a masjid and I accepted Islam. This is a miracle of the Quran. The Quran changes the hearts of people. But even Cat Stevens in the 1970s, Yusuf Islam, his name is now. In the 1970s, he was one of the top pop stars. singers. And he became Muslim in the 1970s. Even he says in his talk sometimes that it's a good job that I didn't meet too many Muslims before I became Muslim, because it most likely I wouldn't have become Muslim. Why is that? The Muslims were praying namaz, the Muslims were giving zakat, the Muslims were fasting and they were going for hajj, but they did not have the decoration, they did not have the akhlaq and the character shown by our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Islamic manners is not only one or two things, there are so many things within Islamic manners. But remember, you cannot be a true Muslim or a complete Muslim until you adorn yourself with the character of Islam. With the character of Islam. It's one of the most important parts of your life. Today, if because of your behavior, one non-Muslim comes to you and you are a businessman and you cheat that non-Muslim, or you behave in an angry manner with no akhlaq, no character, no etiquette, no ethics, and then that person turns around, goes home and he thinks, that person was a Muslim, I will never accept Islam again, I will never accept Islam, I will never even think about becoming part of their religion, how will you show your face on the Day of Judgment? It is very likely that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala aapki pakad kare qiyamah ke din aur aap se ye kahe ki aapke bure akhlaq ki wajah se, because of your bad manners, this person was turned away from Islam. This is why akhlaq, character, is very, very important. And in fact, some of the scholars, many of the scholars, they wrote books on manners. Majority of the hadith books have Kitabul Adab within their hadith books. For example, Mu'ta Imam Malik has Kitabul Adab. Sahih al-Bukhari has Kitabul Adab. Sahih Muslim, in fact, Imam Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi, he wrote a separate book only of Adab, Al-Adabul Mufrad, only for Adab. Similarly, Sahih Muslim also has a kitab which is to do with duty, being dutiful towards fellow Muslims and towards your parents. In Abu Dawud, in Tirmidhi, in Ibn Majah, there's all, everyone has a chapter on manners. And Ibn Mubarak used to say that Mukhlid bin al-Husayn once said to me, we are more in need of acquiring adab and akhlaq more than hadith. We are more in need of acquiring akhlaq and adab more than hadith. Why? Hadith, you can learn hadith, but if you don't put that in practice, then what is the point? What is the point? So akhlaq and manners are an essential, intricate part of Islam. Part of Islam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا دُخُلُوا فِي السِّلْمِ كَافَّةِ وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ. O you who believe, enter into Islam totally. Not only what you think. Today sometimes there used to be Woolworths. Woolworths used to be a shop. And in there used to be pick and mix. You used to go and get sweets and you pick and mix sweets. So today Islam has become pick and mix. Pick and mix. I like this part of Islam, main usko le leta hun. I like this part of Islam, I will take this. I like this part of Islam, I'll take this. This one is difficult, so I'll ignore it. This one is difficult, I'll ignore it. This is why we have today, there are some people who sit in the first saf of the masjid. I'm not talking about this masjid. Eh? Don't start looking tomorrow, kaun baitha hai. You don't start looking, oh, Malisa was talking about him. No, I'm talking about generally, we have people who are sitting in the first saf of the masjid, and yet when they go home, they are doing zulm on their wives. They are oppressing their wives. They are shouting at their wives. They are shouting at their children. They are shouting at their parents. Is that Islam? That you wear your jabba, you wear your beard, and you look and you want to be the chairman of the committee, but at home there is no akhlaq, no manners, and we think that we will go to Jannah like this? No, you have to enter into Islam totally. Enter into Islam totally. And this is why one of the scholars used to say that sometimes adab and akhlaq is needed more than your deeds. Akhlaq and etiquette is needed, manners is needed more than your deeds. And he used to give example that the akhlaq and the character is like flour. And even if you have just a little bit of salt, little bit of deeds, that will be enough because your akhlaq was good. So you do the essentials. You do the essentials. At least the 5 times daily salah. You do the fasting in the month of Ramadan. You do the hajj. You do the zakat. And you stay steadfast on the kalima la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. But akhlaq has to be adorned in all our lives. We have to bring Islamic manners and etiquettes into our lives. Now in terms of akhlaq, there are many, many akhlaq that we need to bring into our lives, but I can only mention a few. But before I mention a few, I want to mention how important akhlaq is according to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a few ways. One, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes and says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. He was a mercy to all the worlds. All the worlds. So that's one description. Another description which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. You are at the highest level of akhlaq. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides to describe the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Quran, what are the two characteristics which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses? One is that He's merciful. This is a character that we need to bring into our lives. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been described as merciful, number one. And number two, with the best of character. So we have to bring the best of character into our lives. And that is why Abdullah bin Amr al-As radiallahu ta'ala used to say, لم يكن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فاحشا ولا متفحشا وكان يقول إن من خياركم أحسنكم خلقا. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, in another hadith, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, Anas رضي الله تعالى عنه used to say, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أحسن الناس خلقا. He was the best of character. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم had the best of character. Had the best of character. And anyone who has the best of character, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, مَا مِنْ شَيْءٍ أَثْقَلْ فِي مِيزَانِ الْمُؤْمِنِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ مِنْ حُسْنِ الْخُلُقِ. That there will be no greater, there will be nothing more weightier, there will be nothing more heavier for a believer on the Day of Judgment in the scales except for good character. Good character. On the Day of Judgment, the heaviest weight, جس دن ہمیں وزن کی ضرورت ہے, amal ki zarurat hogi. On that day we will need amal, we will need actions, we will need deeds. The heaviest deeds will be those of good character. Good character. If you have behaved well, then inshallah that will be heavy on the Day of Judgment. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked, su'ila rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam an akthari ma yadkhulu an-nas al-jannah. What is the most biggest thing that will enter people into Jannah? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, taqwa Allah wa husnul khuluq, taqwa of Allah and good character. This is how important good character is. And an amazing hadith which is narrated by Hazrat Jabir radiallahu ta'ala anhu in Tirmidhi, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, inna min ahabbikum ilayya wa aqrabakum minni majlisan yawm al-qiyama ahasunukum akhlaqa. Allahu Akbar. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the most beloved to me and the most closest to me on the Day of Judgment will be the person with the best of character. The most closest to me and the most beloved to me on the Day of Judgment will be the person with the best of characters. So in terms of character, there are many books that have been written about character. And there are many categories of characters that we need to improve upon. But I just wanted to mention a few of them so that we, and especially those that are prevalent within our society. Number one, our tongue. Our tongue. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, مَنْ يَضْمَنْ لِي مَا بَيْنَ لِحْيَيْهِ وَمَا بَيْنَ لِجْلَيْهِ أَضْمَنْ لَهُ الْجَنَّةِ. أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. that whoever guarantees me that which is between the jaws and that which is between the legs, then I will guarantee them Jannah. This tongue, we make the most problems with our tongue. We either swear at people, we either lie to people, we are angry and we shout at people. This tongue is very dangerous. If you want to improve your character, then you control your tongue. You control your tongue. If you want to improve your character, control your tongue. مَا يَلْفِذُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ. There will be the angels who are writing on your right side, on your left side. Every time you say something, it is written down. This is why the Prophet ﷺ, one of the characteristics that he taught us, مَنْ صَمَتَ نَجَى. مَنْ صَمَتَ نَجَى. Some of our youngsters, every second word is swear word. Every second word, swear word. I was on a call once at home, and it was with somebody who I know quite well, and we were having a conference call. So the phone was in front of us on loudspeaker, and unfortunately the individual, every third sentence there's a swear word. Every third sentence. Now he knows he's speaking to Maulana, but because he's so habitual, itni aadat ban gayi hai ki bas har dusri sentence ke andar ek gaali aa jati hai bas. So if somebody from a young age, you make it your habit never ever to swear, never to swear. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lam yakun fahishan wala mutafahishan. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was never offensive with his language. With his tongue, he was never vulgar. He was never rude. This is a description of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So one of the most foremost characters that we need to improve upon is the tongue. Sheikh Saadi rahmatullah alayhi, he gives an anecdote. He says there was a person who was going to India or Pakistan or wherever he lived, and he had brought these parrots from India or Pakistan, and he brought these parrots and he was keeping them in his house. So when he was traveling back to the jungle where he brought these parrots, he told the parrots, do you want to give any message to your cousins in the jungle? So he said, hamara salam kehne na, give them our salam. So he went, and when he went back to his jungle and he saw other parrots, he said, oh, you know your cousins that I've taken from here and I've locked them up, pinjre ke andar humne, I've locked them up in the cage, they give you salam. So this parrot which was there, he, after listening to the salam, he just fell down. Fell down. So this person is thinking, why has this parrot fallen down? Stayed on the tree, but it fell. Now when he came back, he asked the parrots spoken to him and said, what did my cousin say when we give salam? He said, I gave them your salam and he fell down. So these parrots also fell down in the cage. They fell down in the cage and pretended to be dead. And he said, oi, what's happened to you? So they stayed quiet. He said, what's happened to you? He says, stay quiet. So he opened the cage, he took them out and is trying to see whether they're alive or not. He opened the window to make sure there's air coming in. And when the window opened, they flew away. And Sheikh Saadi rahmatullah alayhi, after giving this anecdote, he was saying, the parrot in India was giving a message to these people that you're speaking too much. When they tell you to say Allahu Akbar, you say Allahu Akbar. The parrot says Allahu Akbar. When they tell you to say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, the parrot says Bismillah. When they say the name, you are saying the name. The parrot in India was giving a message, Man samata naja. Whoever remains silent, saved himself. So now the parrots became quiet and pretended to be dead, opened the cage, opened the window, and they flew away. They got their freedom. Similarly, those people who remain silent the most on the Day of Judgment, they will be the ones who will be free to go to Jannah, because they will have the least hisab to do. So one of the most important characteristics that we need to adopt is our tongue. We need to control our tongue. Stay silent as much as possible. The wife and the husband, sometimes they quarrel, they fight. If both become angry, then the fight is going to be more. But if one becomes silent, then inshallah, then slowly you will be able to make up afterwards, let one cool down. If both people are angry at the same time, then it's going to be a big problem. This is why when Hazrat Sheikh Zulfiqar Damat Barakatuh, he mentions a story in his talk where somebody came to him and said, whenever my husband comes back from work, then we always have a fight. So give us a ta'weez. So Hazrat Sheikh Zulfiqar Sahib said, whenever your husband comes back from work, then you put a sweet in your mouth and you don't talk for 1 hour. Gobstopper. There used to be a little sweet before which is called gobstopper. We should try and put that in our mouths much more often. Isse hamara gob band ho jayega. So then she put this sweet. After 1 month she came back and said, hamara jagre khatam ho gaye. Our fights are finished. But she wanted to know, ke sweet ke andar kya rakha tha? What was in the sweet? So there was nothing in the sweet. When your husband comes back tired from work, then you saying, oh, ye nahi hua, ye kaam nahi hua, ye kaam nahi hua. He's already angry from work, and then you make him more angry and you're fighting. Man samata naja. We have to, one of the most important characteristics that we need to adopt is controlling of the tongue. What happens with our tongue? Number one, we should not swear. Any non-Muslim who sees Muslims swearing, they will think, what is the difference between being a Muslim and non-Muslim? But if we don't swear and somebody asks you, why don't you swear? He says, my Prophet ﷺ taught us never to swear. My Prophet ﷺ was never vulgar with his tongue. My Prophet ﷺ was never rude with his tongue. My Prophet ﷺ was never offensive with his tongue. Then they will realize, oh, this is because of their deed. What a beautiful teaching. Then number two, never lie. Never ever lie. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in one hadith, he mentioned the three traits of a hypocrite. Ayatul munafiqi thalathun. Idha haddatha kadhab. Wa idha wa'ada akhlafa. Wa idha tumina khana. That a trait of a hypocrite, a person who says he's Muslim but in reality is not Muslim, is that when he speaks, he lies. Never ever lie. Again, non-Muslims see Muslims in this country always lying. If you look at cheating in business, and if you look at the countries, the top countries in the world who cheat, one will be Nigeria and one will be Pakistan. No offense to anyone who is from that country. I'm just saying, if you look at those countries, there are charts and there are tables where they say where there's the most fraud going on. And it will be, how many Muslim countries, Muslim people who are cheating others? Where have we learned this from? We are supposed to be the most honest. When the Sahaba went to Indonesia and the Tabi'un went to Indonesia, the Indonesian people, they did not see one sword. They did not see one fight. All they saw were these people who were truthful, who were honest in their business. And Indonesia is the most populated Muslim country in the world today. Why? Because of akhlaq and character. Our tongue has so much to do with our character. We have to stop swearing. We have to stop lying. We have to stop cheating in our businesses. Today we think, you know, main namaz to padhta hu, koi baat nahi, yahan ek do paise idhar le liye udhar le liye, namaz to padhta hu, zakat bhi de deta hu, wo chori kiye hue paise ki bhi zakat to deta hu. Money that I have stolen, at least I give zakat on that. You don't think that in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He describes the people of Hazrat Shu'aib alayhi salatu wa salam, وَلَا تَنْقُصُ الْمِكْيَالَ وَالْمِيزَانِ. Hazrat Shu'aib alayhi salatu wa salam's people, what were they doing wrong? In the Quran it is mentioned that those people, they were cheating in their scales. They used to say, yeah, this is 3 kilograms, when it was really 1 kilogram. They used to say it's 5 kilograms, when it was only 2 kilograms. They were cheating. And Shu'aib alayhi salatu wa salam was telling them, don't cheat. And that qawm, Allah Pak ne us qawm ko halak kar diya cheating ki wajah se. Puri qawm. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala annihilated a whole ummah of Shu'aib alayhi salam, a whole people of Shu'aib alayhi salatu wa salam for what sin? Cheating. And today we think it's light. So with your tongue, do not swear. Always be truthful. Do not cheat. Backbiting. This is also part of character. There are so many faults within us. We really need to look at, how do I develop my character? Character is developed through environment. Sometimes the parents will put in that character into the children. Don't lie, don't swear, don't backbite. We as parents, but we ourselves are lying. We ourselves are cheating. We ourselves are backbiting. How are we going to develop our character? We have to look into our kitabs. We have to go to the ulama. We have to sit in good gatherings. Go to jama'at, go to ulama, sit in their gatherings and learn what character, what faults is within my character. Mere andar kya khami hai? Mere andar kya khami hai? Because without this, we will not be able to beautify our own houses. People might say, bahut deendar hai. Why? Because pagri pehni hai, jabba pehna hai, dari hai. No. This is not Islam. Islam is character. The way you speak gently to people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَمْ فَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. He told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that if you were hard-hearted and your tongue was sakhat, your tongue was harsh and your heart was harsh, then these companions would have moved away from you. Soft-hearted. Be soft, be gentle in your tongue, in your heart. When Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and Harun alayhi salatu wasalam were sent to Fir'aun, Fir'aun was the worst person on the earth. And yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them, go and speak to him gently. Narmi ke saath baat karo. Go and speak to him gently. Our tongue has everything to do with our character. Number one item that we need to improve. Are we backbiting regularly? So many times we are speaking about other people and we don't even realize. Dusron ki baatein karte hain, unki ghair maujoodgi ke andar, ye hai ghibat. Bahut bada guna. It's a huge, huge sin. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا فَكَرِهْتُمُوهُ. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ. Do not backbite your brother or your sister. Do not backbite. And what is backbiting? That you talk about somebody which they would dislike. أَتَدْرُونَ مَا الْغِيبَ. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked the companions, أَتَدْرُونَ مَا الْغِيبَ. Do you know what is ghiba? The companion says, اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَعْلَمْ. Allah aur uske rasool zyada jante hain. O Prophet of Allah, you and Allah know better. Dhikruka akhaka bima yakrah. To talk about your fellow human being behind their back which they would dislike. Koi bhi baat kisi ke bare mein aapne unki ghair maujoodgi ke andar ki aur unko na pasand ho, this is ghibah. The companions asked, O Prophet of Allah, what if that trait or characteristic is within them? Sahaba ne pucha ke agar wo baat unke andar hai waqi ke usne jhoot bola hai ya wo bura hai ya wo waisa hai wo taisa hai, agar wo baat unke andar hai aur fir humne baat ki to fir. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that is ghiba, that is ghiba. And if that trait is not within them, then that is a false accusation. That is buhtan, which is even worse. Even worse. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Al-ghibatu ashaddu min az-zina." Ghibat is worse than zina. Ghibat is worse than zina. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. Somebody who does zina, hum usko bura samajhte hain, and rightly so. Agar kisi ne zina kar liya to hum usko bura samajhte hain. If somebody has done fornication, somebody has done adultery, we say, "Oh, that girl next door, she was with that boy." But us saying that, hum usko bura nahi samajhte. When we speak within our families to say, "I saw this girl with that boy," uski burai karne ke liye, you're not going to solve anything. You are just saying something to make her look bad. You count that fornication as a sin. You count that adultery as a sin. But you speaking about it, you don't even consider it a sin. The reason why Prophet ﷺ said that ghibat is worse than zina, that girl that you saw with that boy, Ramzan might come and she might turn to Allah and say, "Oh Allah, please forgive me. Usne to tawbah kar liya." But you will never do tawbah because you've never thought that you've done anything wrong. Aapne to tawbah hi nahi kiya. Kyun? Isliye ki aapne to socha hi nahi ki maine galat kaam kiya. This is why ghibat is so bad. One of the most important characteristics that you and I need to improve the most, our tongue. No lying, no swearing, no backbiting, no cheating. Anything, no buhtan, no false accusation. These are just a few examples of the sins of the tongue. But if we improve the tongue, we will improve so much. Then, just to go briefly through some of the other points of sins that we commit. WhatsApp, Islamic manners. There are people sitting around you and they are talking to you and you are on your phone. This is against Islamic manners, against Islamic etiquettes. Another bad habit that we all have, we receive a message and it says, "This happened in India," or "This happened in Bangladesh," or "This happened in Pakistan," or "If you read this, then this will happen and this will happen." We don't verify. Hum ye nahi dekhte ki ye sach hai ya jhoot hai, bas isko aage kar dete hai. We forward the message. Sometimes I receive message that if you do this and then send it to 10 people, aapka bahut bhala ho jayega. Then you will have a very nice day. I don't send it to 10 people, I still have a nice day. Why? Because this is iman. Iman. If somebody thinks that by forwarding a message, then something good will happen, where is your iman? Only Allah makes good happen. Not by you sending messages, by you putting your forehead on the ground, then Allah will make things happen. Not by forwarding messages to 10 people. So don't forward things just like this. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu in ja'akum fasiqun binaba'in fatabayyanu. Quran says, this is Islamic manners, is character, that you don't just forward anything and everything. Today in the news, the media, there is no manners, there is no akhlaq, there is no character. It's about selling newspapers. As many newspapers as possible, this is their goal. It's got nothing to do with akhlaq and nothing to do with manners. This is why, jhoot ho, sach ho, jo kuch bhi ho, they will put anything in the newspapers. That is not manners. If there was an Islamically run newspaper, then it will only mention something which is true, not something which is false or something which is speculation. And all the newspapers are full of speculation, and all the newspapers are full of false, and sometimes there is some truth. Sometimes there is some truth. Even the politicians today, one of the politicians who is in our parliament, she's the youngest politician, youngest MP in the parliament today. She is from the Scottish Party, and SNP, Scottish National Party. Myra Black is her name. She gave a talk 3-4 days ago, something to do with pensions. And while she was speaking, she mashallah speaks quite well and she speaks the truth. She said that she went to media training. When a politician comes in front of the camera, what they have in their heart is something and what they say by the tongue is something else. Islam doesn't say this. And this politician, she said that I went to media training 3-4 days ago. And in the media training, I was taught that if you've done something wrong and then you get a difficult question, then don't answer the question, talk about something else. Yani usne khud iqrar kiya. She said herself, you look at what's happening in America today in terms of politicians. One slander here, one slander here, one slander here, one slander here. Nothing about making something good for the people. It's slandering one another. So Islam is based upon character. Whether it's on your phone or whether it's your speaking, wherever you are, you have to look at your character. How am I behaving? How am I behaving? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned about forwarding WhatsApp messages. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Kafa bil mar'i kadiban ay yuhaddith bi kulli ma sami'a." It is enough for a person to become a liar just by telling people whatever he heard. Ye baat suni humne keh di. Ye baat suni humne keh di. Ye baat WhatsApp aaya maine forward kar diya. Is tarah log aapko jhoota kehne lagenge. People will start calling you a liar. كَفَى بِالْمَرْءِ كَذِبًا أَن يُحَدِّثَ بِكُلِّ مَا سَمِعَ. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the most beautiful deen. And in there, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us beautiful character. He came to teach us character. إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِأُتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ. I was sent to teach you the best of character, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. And in every single area, one is the tongue which I've mentioned today. Our elders, respecting our elders. What kind of respect do we have? We are, previously people used to respect the elders. Now instead of teaching the host community how to respect elders, humne bhi usko chhod diya. Humne bhi usko chhod diya. Before, I went to a conference. And in there I was sitting on the panel. In Cambridge University. This was about 2-3 months ago. And we were talking about care of the elderly. Looking after elderly people. Or care of the dying. And one Indian student who was from India, who is studying in Cambridge, she stood up. And she said that one of the things that I have found different from India and sub-Asian continent to this country is that in India and Pakistan and Bangladesh, we look after our elders, but in this country, people just put them in old people's home. And now, not only is that used to happen, but now we Muslims are also doing the same. We should be teaching them how to look after the elderly. But instead, we are doing the same. One day, one son and his father were going with the grandfather, and he was going in the car, and then he dropped him off at the old people's home. On the way back, the son asked the father that, "Oh father, where have you put grandfather?" He said, "Because, you know, grandfather keeps on shouting too much. He doesn't have much memory left, so he keeps talking too much. And then he hasn't got control of his bladder, so we have to clean up too much. So I went to put him in an old people's home." So the son said, "Thank you very much, father. I wanted to know so that when you become old, I know where to put you as well. I know where to put you." This is where we are. Whereas the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allahu Akbar, he used to respect the elders. He used to respect the elders. And he used to say that if in knowledge people are the same, then the person who is the most age, that person will lead the salah. That person will lead the salah. One person, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to tell him about a murder that had happened. So he was there when the murder happened, but he brought his elder brother. When he started speaking, the Prophet ﷺ said, no, the elder one speaks. The elder one speaks. When Prophet ﷺ and the Sahaba, when they used to walk, if the elder person was there, the elder used to walk at the front and the person behind used to walk slightly on the right, behind them. Where is our character? Where is our character gone? Now we are doing the same as these people. What's the difference? What's the difference? Respecting our elders, respecting our parents. Those people who watch EastEnders, you notice, and I don't watch EastEnders, okay? But I know lots of non-Muslim people. And I understand that when they speak to their parents, they call them with their first name. Are you alright, John? Are you alright, Mary? No mom and dad anymore. And our children are picking up the same. There is no respect for parents anymore. The Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, لا تقل لهما أفٍ. Don't even say أف to your parents. And today, we don't take our parents seriously. We really need to look at the Islamic character. If in this country, Muslims started to adopt Islamic character and manners, then we don't need to call people towards Islam, they'll come in their droves. خود بخود آ جائیں گے. But one last point I'd like to make, that all this character, alhamdulillah, in the last year or so, we have realized that we need to bring these non-Muslims closer to us, because they've got lots of hatred towards Muslims. So now we see Muslims who are cleaning the streets. Now we see Muslims that when the floods are happening in Cumbria, then Muslims are going to help, which is good, alhamdulillah. This is how it should be. But always remember that akhlaq, to show people, there is no reward for that. It's akhlaq with ikhlas. With ikhlas and sincerity. Akhlaq and character with sincerity. If we're going to help our elders, we help for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we're going to be good to our parents, we be good for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we're going to be kind to our neighbors, we be good because it is our Islam and because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be pleased. If we are going to clean the streets, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, keep your neighborhood clean, that is why we will do it. Do everything because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not left us yateem and orphans. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us everything. This is why when Salman Farsi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was once with his companion who was non-Muslim, and he said to him that, you know, your religion, your deen, I understand that your Prophet even taught you how to go toilet. Mazak mein. He was trying to take the mickey out of Salman Farsi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and Salman Farsi radiallahu ta'ala anhu turned it around and he said, yes, of course, mujhe fakhr hai, I am proud that my Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came and he also taught us how to enter into the toilet, how to perform the toilet, how to wash ourselves out after the toilet, and how to come out of the toilet as well and read the dua. Ye to hamare liye fakhr ki baat hai, that every single area of our lives, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has showed us that this is the beautiful character and beautiful way that you should lead your lives. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to understand what are our duties in terms of our Islamic manners and how to behave. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala improve us in our characters so that people see us and they start becoming Muslim. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika wa nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta wa nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayka.